As a believer, we got to know what happens in our lives is not random. You got to know the healing that you have is not random. And the family you have is not random. And the joy you have is not random. And the peace you have is not random. And the overflow you have is not random. And the baby you have is not random. And the blessings you have, those are not random. The outcome is not possible randomly. You can't have this joy randomly. You can't have this peace randomly. You can't have this triumph randomly. It had to be the intervention from above to make a difference in your life. So when you start talking about statistical significance, it's saying that this outcome could not be possible randomly. It had to come from this intervention. In order now to get after everything folk in here been through, and you still love them, and you still smiling, and you're still upright, and still decided that life is worth a living, that could not happen randomly. It's because you know the Redeemer, somebody who is good all the time, and somebody who's great all the time, and somebody who has given you significance and triumph and also abundance. So this idea, so whatever is going on in the life of a believer, what are we saying here? It is not random. God's presence in our lives is what guides from where we are, from where we were to where we are. So now our role is to get somebody from where they were where they should be as well. Statistically, it says, right, the outcome is not possible randomly. The only way to get this outcome is by some intervention. The only way to get where we are right now is by being saved. So here's the fact. So we are the experimental group because we've already accepted Jesus Christ as our Lord. The control group is the world. There ought to be some difference statistically between what we see and what they see, because we got the presence of the living God in our lives. Is God moving? Is God living? Is God showing up? Is God showing out in our lives? Because we are the experimental group, because we're saved. What's going on in our lives wasn't random. What's going on in our lives wasn't luck. What's going on in our lives was not accidental. It was the intervention of a mighty God that has us where we are. Right now, you can think about stuff you went through just a few years ago and where you were mentally. Wonder if you wanted to get up the next morning. Wonder if you could get up the next morning. Wonder at this point if it's worth getting going forward. And it came because of the intervention of a mighty good God that said life is worth the living. And over in Psalm 3, he said, you, O Lord, are my shield, and you are my glory, and you are a lifter of my head. Don't you walk around with your head held down, because God is your glory, and God is your shield, and God is the one that lifts up your head. The reason life is worth the living is because of the intervention of an infinite God. God is statistically significant. I wish I knew that from Texas. This is that idea that God is the one. This infinite God has had an intervention in our lives. And where we are right now couldn't be here randomly. Look at some folks you start off with and see where they are. The difference was not because you're better. It's because we know somebody who's stronger. The idea was that there's a difference. They started off even ahead of you. But because you trusted God and relied on God, at this point now you had the intervention from an infinite one, glory, that you are now where you are, not randomly, but because God chose the path for you to be in that you're on right now. So this idea, so we have triumphant, we have this abundant, and so we don't go back to it. That's a whole other class. But that, the next one is abundant. Now these two definitions, we talked about this one definition last week, and I want to give you this one and add one more. Abundance certainly means above measure. Above measure. Gave the analogy before that when years ago when it was safe to go and they didn't know any better, went trick-or-treating when I was 8 years old, we'd go down trick-or-treating and everybody, we had these little ugly pumpkins, little plastic pumpkins that mama got for 59 cents down from the corner that they were left all over, and it had a little black strap. And your little black strap broke. You try to take that thing together, looking all bootleg, going trick or treat. And then you know at that point, mom didn't have any money to buy a costume, so she put a sheet on you, talking about you Casper, the friendly go. You know what I'm talking about, that man. You didn't have the money to go get become Thor and the Hulk of the Avengers. You better get that sheet. Now, you wonder why they put the sheet on you that had the flowers on it. You are a flower Casper today. You kind of Casper. And put your arms in there, ooh, and go down trick or treat. But when you got there, that you could only get enough of candy that fit into the bucket. And it was a painful thing for a kid to see more candy available, but my little bucket only held this much. So there's a lady down the street from us, three houses down. And you know, and don't go over in that doorbell when the light comes on, because at that point you may get shot. You come over here, you get these long lights off, go ding dong, trick or treat. But then there was one lady who was there, and we'll come back in, and I think my mom had been somewhere, she was taking me around there. And just before I saw the light, the lady was about to take it on. I take the doorbell, this and that. So and she had all this candy left, because she was somewhere away. And she filled up my little bucket. And she said, if you just had another bucket, you could get more. She had all this candy over here, this big container. And my little container was already full. So I went in there and said, could you leave the light on just for a minute? I went home, ran home as fast as I could, dumped that out on the bed, and ran back and got more. So what happened? She had so much candy, it overflowed out of my little cheap orange bucket. Well, God is saying, you expected me to do this, and I'm a God who can do exceedingly abundantly above all you can ask or think according to the power that works within you. I got some more for you, but you don't have more because your bucket too small. I need you to get a bigger bucket. Tonight, put the bigger your bucket, I can keep giving you more and having more and more and more because it's beyond measure. Got more joy for you, but your container too small. Got more love for you, container too small. Got more forgiveness for you. You can't stand that person, you can't too small. At this point, I got all this over here. I have so much, you don't have enough containers to catch it. But because at this point, you're content with this little bucket right here, and I got all this for you as well. So beyond measure is one of our definitions here. But I love this for abundance. It means unbelievable satisfaction. Unbelievable satisfaction. That's what abundance is. At some point as believers, we have to experience life with having unbelievable satisfaction. Like I just didn't even know this kind of satisfaction was available. Like even last night, I'll give you an example. My wife is just a wonderful cook. And she goes on the internet all the time looking for recipes. So she's gonna make this turkey lasagna. Low carb. Y'all should have known this. So that here was it. That means no sugar, no noodles. It was no taste, but it was good. So I knew she went and made this thing. And she went back in here, and she's pacing back and forth in the kitchen. I'm like, she's about to wear a little panel out on the floor. Just going back and forth. Pulls it out, lets it cool off for a while, puts it on the plate. So you know when you look at spoil, you can tell somebody lives inside your eyes. So I'm looking forward. I'm like, all I want to do is I want to eat food. And I'm just watching the snack. Trying to see how I'm going to respond. The pressure's on. So even if it was bad with that much pressure, see that smile. But I've never had a bad meal. So I ate that and I was like, girl, you know you cook this thing? And it was good for me, it was good. Went back for seconds, would have gone back for Thursday, she didn't put it in the refrigerator all there. The boy gave some unbelievable satisfaction. She had this new dish. She said, we're going to live strong and we're going to live long. Amen. Somebody, we're going to live, that's our mantra. We're going to live long and we're going to live strong. I don't know that that's going to be, but I'm telling you right here, I'm going to live long. And so it happens. So she wants to make sure, and as challenging as it is, to go back and not have real food at the house, that she won't be that thing. And it still is troubling to me. She went and made, and we had some harvest grain pancakes from IHOP yesterday. Like, what did I do to deserve that? Then gonna put some low sugar syrup. You can't go back and get some. That ain't making sense. Sugar-free syrup. What is it? Sugar-free syrup, not dessert, got sugar. I tasted that thing with a hair stood up on the ears. I was like, no. So praise God for being a God of overflow. Way in the back of the cupboard. May have been 20 years old, but there's an Auntie Mammy back there. And I said, Auntie, I praise God you back here. I'm glad you got unto you today. And by the time I put Auntie on the pillow, oh, glory to God. So the idea was, but it's an unbelievable satisfaction. Abundance says we ought to have some unbelievable satisfaction in our lives. There ought to be some point in life where you're just amazed about how good God is. There ought to be some point in life you just think for how good God is. There ought to be some place in life where you say, back in the heaven I've been for the Lord on my side, I wouldn't be here. Some unbelievable. See, we always think about abundance just by having a whole lot. That's true. But there ought to be so much, there ought to be at least one area in the life of a believer where we look back and say, God, I'm just humbled and thankful that you love me so much to have this. Well, for us, it's coming here to see y'all. I'm telling you, the height of our life. Yeah, I got to take advantage of Sundays because I was only going to see you Tuesday. But yeah, I'm just glad to see y'all. It's honored. Because I remember what it was like to look in the doors of this church when it was on the market and wonder what was inside. Now we got the key and the code. The gospel line. It's unbelievable satisfaction. So this abundance here that we have here. Now look what happens here. So this is abundance right here. This is our imagery for abundance. Now, in this idea, this is what we spent some time talking about last week very quickly. Abundance versus scarcity. Abundance versus scarcity. The world has a view of scarcity. Now, again, using this as the world, using this as the word. The world has a scarcity mentality. That if you get something, it takes away from me. Tell the world things. So that's how it can be easy for somebody to go rob somebody or somebody to go back and pull somebody down, the crab mentality. Because if you go high, it means I got to end up being low, so I got to pull you down so I can go high. The word says there's not a scarcity mentality. There's an abundance mentality. Let me make this clear for y'all. Even this past week, we had, you know, in the school system, they're having all of these the benchmarks and everything. And so I was proctoring something a few days ago, and this one student asked, and I was supposed to talk one at a time, asked for an eraser, you know, to erase the marks on it, because, you know, it's by paper and everything, So I gave out this one eraser. So it was the eraser, but, you know, he had a little picture pencil, so you put a little top on it. And so when this student got to stretch, person next to it stole. Just took it. It's like right in front of me. Just took it. So the person sits back down. Then they start sharing it. So they're not able to work on their test because they're trying to erase something or stealing something and wasting time. What they didn't know was I had a whole box of erasers in my drawer. They're trying so hard to work on that one little eraser, stealing and taking it around and losing time. All they had to do was ask for more, and I had enough. All of them have more than enough. As a believer and as the world will have you think that if this person does well, it's at your expense. I'm about to take your job. Now, again, then the world will have you think at this point that if they do well, you got to do poorly. God said at this point, there's more than enough for everybody. And so stop fighting each other over here. There's something else over here we can get instead. And we got to transition from, be transformed by the renewal of our mind, from a scarcity, not enough mentality, to a more than enough mentality. Let's keep going with this abundance as well. It's abundance. So read this with me right now, please. We talked about this last week. Now, give us another one. Let's read this together. I live and I breathe each day from the perspective I am abundant. From the perspective of what? I am abundant. From the perspective of what? All right, let's go with this one right here now. And then the beautiful just ties in with our colors. Well, let me read this right here. Listen. I am, keep on going, open and ready to attract abundance into my life. Come on, let's read that again. I am what? Open and ready to do what? Attract abundance into my life. One more time. I am what? Open and ready to attract abundance into my life. Anybody here really open and ready to attract abundance in your life right now? I say, you've been open and ready. So what does that mean? But that only comes with a transformed mind. That now God's will has to be above everything. That the more we are doing God's will, the more stuff just gets attracted. It gets attracted. But as we try to do our will, instead, we start repelling. Come on now. So there's stuff that's being repelled. You got to say, am I trying to do my will Or am I doing God's will? Because God said at this point, you do my will, you're going to prove my perfect will by a transformed mind. You're going to prove what I want. You're going to show some evidence of who I am. And because of the fact of being things being abundant, being attracted into your life. Let me make this video for you. This is just some beautiful testimony not too long ago. So we have.